All right, good morning everyone on Zoom. We're just getting started. I'm gonna go ahead and connect to our Facebook. So go ahead and roll on in and we'll get started in just a minute. All right, good morning, folks. Here we are on a beautiful Thursday in Michigan. I must confess that we're coming to you from the road, which is why we're online only, but we're excited to see those of you joining us on Zoom. See some folks still rolling in, and we'll start in just a sec.
Sounds good.
I will tell you, as we get going on our Zoom here, we're also live streaming on Facebook. You can send any comments, questions into both our chat. We also have the Q&A feature enabled. So if you'd like to feed a question there, you can go ahead and do so. Yeah. Let's see what time we have. All right, I think we're gonna go ahead and get started. I'm gonna begin with my welcome here. Good morning, my name is Liz Erlewine. I'm Visual Arts Director here at Crooked Tree Art Center in Petoskey and Traverse City. You are joining us for a presentation that is put together in conjunction with an exhibition that we currently have on display at Crooked Tree Art Center Petoskey. We have the pleasure of hosting a show called Honky Tonk, Photographs by Henry Horenstein. This show opened at the beginning of the month and will run through September 3rd. It's a solo exhibition by Boston-based photographer Henry Horenstein. It features 20 black and white photographs that he took mostly in the 1970s, documenting the country music scene that he was experiencing at that time. The photographs are personal, but also contain images of plenty of favorite celebrities in backstage settings, and it's a lot of fun to see. When I was putting this exhibition together for our audiences, I had a couple different things that I was thinking about doing to kind of expand on these images and kind of bring this moment of history and these images to life. So we do have a series of these Coffee at 10 presentations going on. They were made possible with thanks to the Charlevoix County Community Foundation. So thank you there. And many of our presentations are sponsored by local Roast and Toast in Petoskey, Michigan. So thanks to those guys. Our programs are also made possible thanks to Crooked Tree Art Center members. So if you are a member, thank you so much. If you're not yet a member, give us a call and we can help you with that. These series of presentations are inspired by what we had on display, but this particular presentation today is one that I've been very excited to share with you because we're bringing our very own guest here, Stephen Thomas Erlewine. You may notice we share a last name and we are indeed siblings. So when I decided to bring Henry's works to the galleries, I knew my space and I knew my audiences and I knew I had a little bit of more space to fill. And I was also excited to kind of bring this moment of history to life. So I called upon someone who I really knew would know about this stuff. And that's my brother, Tom. His professional name is Stephen Thomas Erlewine, but you're going to hear me call him Tom. Don't be alarmed.
That's what I go by. So don't change that.
So Tom, being my brother, I've known my whole life, and he honestly had been collecting music since I think he was about five, three.
Well, it depends if you count Disney records, which I sort of do, because there's these old pictures of me surrounded by all the Disney records I could find, which were numerous. But yeah, and I also remember getting lots of records around, you know, eight or nine, which is, I think, probably a little early for starting to collect records.
So needless to say, yeah. I always had someone to go to when I had a question about music, was looking for some new music. Tom has been fortunate to build his professional life in music. So I'm going to let him go ahead and tell you a little bit about that. But knowing I had this resource, I said, hey, Tom, I've got this show coming. I wonder, would you be willing to kind of expand on this and answer some questions for our audiences through writing? So when you visit that show, you're going to see a number of didactic text panels that talk about this time mm-hmm. and place. And that's what we get to dig into a little bit today. So Tom and I talk, we want to keep it informal. Go ahead and if you've got a question, just type it into that chat in the Q&A and I'll feed it into the conversation as appropriate. So with that, Tom, I'm going to stop yakking and you can go ahead and tell us a little bit about you and let's get started.
Yeah, so thank you so much, Liz, for the introduction and for having me. I've been really excited about this exhibit since the moment that Liz told me about it. I've wound up being a very, very much a big fan of country music, and that's one of my specialties in terms of professional specialties in terms of what I coverage. And it's something that sort of came to me slowly throughout my life. Like, I remember when we were growing up, our parents were really big Merle Haggard fans. And I remember Merle Haggard and Bob Wills, who was the king of Western swing. Those records I remember playing around the house. And Merle Haggard is from California, from Bakersfield particularly. And he's, I think, one of the giants of the 20th century. And that would be my second concert, I think, was seeing Merle Haggard at the State Fair with our parents, which was really awesome. But for me, I started working professionally during college. Like, I would, the company that I worked for was at first called All Music Guide, which was a series of books, basically record guides that would help give capsule information on artists. So if you went to Merle Haggard or Hank Williams, you'd get an idea of the bio overview, and then you would see what records you should start with. And that expanded, so it started as a book project, then it expanded into a database. It was so you could go, and the website's still up. The corporate shenanigans means that technically I work for a different company, but you can go to All Music and you can, any musician or artist that you hear about today, there's bound to be an entry for them, and you can get a biography plus looking at their discography and figure out like where to start if you wanted to dig deeper. So that was the genesis of my professional career. And then in college, I would like go back and forth between working at All Music and working at the Michigan Daily at University of Michigan, and also occasionally do a little bit of radio, but it's like just full-on immersion for a long time. And like after college, I would be working on the books and the database, probably a little bit too heavily, but we built this thing that wound up getting licensed throughout the internet. So if you wind up going to Spotify or Apple Music, or there's going to be some version of our data or our text. And along the way, we did our first country book in the late 90s, around 97, 98, because we the first guide was completely like all genres, which is great, but the text was probably 8-point type, very difficult to read. But we decided to break it down to jazz and blues and rock, and then eventually country, which was something that me and my friend and colleague Chris Woodstra were really pushing, because country music has a rich history, and it's a complex history, and I think it also is very much tied into pop. It has been a popular music. Like, if you go back through the years, you see pop music and country get intertwined in ways that you might not expect. Like with the rise of Hank Williams, who's really the number one honky tonk hero, he helps become a national star when Tony Bennett, the pop singer, sings Cold Cold Heart and has a number one hit with it. So there's these parallel tracks going, and it continues to go and sometimes converge and sometimes merge or are on parallel tracks. And it's very interesting. And then you also have the question of authenticity in terms of country music, which is somewhat of an invented question. I think like there's the idea that this has always been like rural folk music, and it has the roots in that, but it's also been very much reflecting of the times. And I think Honky Tonk in particular reflects the times. And if you look at the photographs that Henry Hornstein has here, it captures a particular era that's sort of like a culmination that start of things that start in the 40s. Because one of the things I really like in the exhibit are the pictures of the venues and the people that are the attendees and the fans. It's great to see the stars. It's great to see the musicians, but you actually get a sense of the character of the place when you see the insides of the dance halls and the people enjoying themselves. And I think that's sort of a culmination of what started with the 40s with Ernest Tubb and first big hit, Walking the Floor Over You. Now here is Tootsie's Orchid Lounge, which is in Nashville, Tennessee. And this is sort of like the stereotypical, or like, it's the Uber honky tonk. Like this is the one that people still talk about and it's still active. And you can see that it's a contemporary photograph and it just pops like this. And it's stayed there over the years. And, you know, I know that I've had a friend's play there, but it's, you know, it's sort of a tourist attraction now because it's that sort of culture that's depicted in the exhibit sort of has faded away. They're still there, but like, I think that it's wound up becoming more sports bars like over the years. Like you don't really have, you have live music sometimes, but like the onslaught of jukeboxes and that country culture becomes more bigger and corporatized in the 1990s with Garth Brooks.
Pause you there for just a second. And I'm curious, some of the stuff you talk about, and when I was embarking on putting the show together and talking with you about it, is a conversation about the distinction between honky tonk as a sound, a honky tonk as a scene, honky tonk as a place, right? And I know that Henry was actually just at Cricket Tree and got to talk about his work. And he mentioned how he was shooting at Tootsie's, like, oh, I got to capture this before it's gone. And now here it still is. Can you talk about that a little bit?
No, that's a really good point about like the evolution of honky tonk, because it is named after the sound that came out of bars. And like it's widely thought to be like piano-based music that was really rollicking and sort of boogie-based with heavy bass. And it's possible that it's honky tonk is also named after the kind of piano that's there. And so it just became sort of not quite a, it became a colloquialism, and I just garbled that word, but you know, like, because the kind of music that was played there was honky tonk, and so then the places became honky tonk, and then as these juke joints and bar joints become known as honky tonk, a certain kind of music played, and it actually moves away from the piano and it becomes more guitar and fiddle and bass. And like if you're looking, and a little bit of steel guitar, but at first in the 40s into the 50s, which it would be Ernest Tubb into Hank Williams, you're not really talking about electric instruments much. And electric instruments were even sort of, I believe, banned at the Grand Ole Opry for a long time until maybe the 1960s. And it's because, you know, country music changes with the times, but certain traditions take a while for them to shake loose. And so you start, it would be during that sort of prime era of Hank Williams that honky tonk becomes, that's Ernest Tubb right there. Honky tonk becomes a specific sound that is identifiable as, you know, songs about drinking, love, loss, cheating, and your cheating heart. And that all is based on that particular era. And then it evolves a lot toward the end of the 50s when there's a Texan singer called Ray Price. He develops a very distinctive honky tonk shuffle. Like it's I can't really describe it, but it has more and he sort of like straight boogie with a doubled up rhythm beat. And that becomes an incredibly influential sound. And he also has electric instruments. And he was also a great talent scout. Willie Nelson was in his band, Roger Miller, and countless other people who became major stars of their own right. And so I think that what you start to hear from after Hank Williams' death to in the mid early 50s, but towards the back end of the 50s into the 60s is due to Ray Price.
So that's interesting to me. I'm going to take it back a little personal for a second too. Like when I first started listening to country music or hearing it, I should say, growing up in small town Midwest America in the 90s, I was like, ooh, country music, right? So you have these fond memories of Merle Haggard, but I was like, oh no, you know, that's not for me. I've certainly changed, obviously, and opened my mind to things. And I got really into Hank Williams, and that's interesting as the start there. But one thing you just said a moment ago was about Ernest Tubb starting these songs that are all about the, you know, the challenges of simple living, right? You know, the heartache, the drinking, and all these kinds of things. So is that, was that part of country music before kind of honky tonk emerged as a distinct sound? Or
sure. I mean, like if you look back on old folk ballads, there's all sorts of real topics and, you know, heartache and loss and also, and, you know, cautionary tales, like Tell It to Me is like, drink the corn liquor, let the cocaine be. And like there's, so these are things that are commonalities, but I think that the way that I sort of look at it is honky tonk seems to address modern concerns. Like right now we can see it be classic if we look at Walking the Floor Over You or Move It On Over from Hank Williams or any of his stuff, but it's a different kind of vernacular in a sense. Like it's more immediate, it's more concise songs, and it's things that actually sort of work more in an urban setting. Now, it wasn't necessary, it still was country based, rural based, but it really did, it started to make inroads for country folk living in cities too. I mean, if you look at some of the photographs that Henry has here, is that they're big cities. Like not just Nashville or Austin, there's a honky tonk in Boston, and for a post-war period, there would be lots of honky tonks in little towns, but also big towns too. So, and I think that it becomes an evolution of both topic and themes, and also sounds, and because once you start getting to 1950s or so, it becomes just sort of harder, like in terms of maturity things. It's like it, compared to pop songs, which tended to be a little bit lighter, there would be like more of a gritty undercurrent in the country songs. So
I should specify that the photo we're looking at here is not one of Henry's, right? This would have been an older image. And then I think you might have an image of Hank Williams that I feel like we ought to throw up there, because I got to say that even when I went through with a younger audience, they're like, oh, where's Hank Williams? And then I have to explain, well, he wouldn't have been around in 1970s to be part of Henry's photos. You want to tell us a little bit about him and how influential he was?
No, it's a fascinating, I would say that Hank Williams is like the defining figure of 20th century country and really one of the 20th century's biggest artists, period. Like he wasn't around for very long, and he died before he was 30, but he was an incredible songwriter and a really fantastic singer that he's kind of created that live fast, love hard, die young mythos that still sort of permeated country music until I would say recently. I think that, you know, there's still lots of references to Hank, but I think that because he burned so brightly that he was basically a supernova. And then he came on the scene. He was a rebel. He didn't really play by the rules, and he excited audiences. He got onto the Opry and then get kicked off of the Opry. And all the while, and he has this very tumultuous life with his wife, Aubrey. And he's all the while he's making incredible records and incredible songs. And so many of his songs became standards, whether it's like the gospel, I Saw the Light, or Jambalaya, and Your Cheating Heart. And he died in a limo on the road to the show. And so it's like you have this, it's almost a mythic fable, really. And so people like can keep retelling it. There has been a movie made of it recently, but it really shows up in country songs all the time. And his son, Hank Williams Jr., also became a really huge influential star in his own right. And I think that really helped steer country music towards the bigger rock oriented sound that took hold into the 90s and 2000s. And that just kept, he's probably the most iconic figure in country music. So, and I think that after his death, there was a big hole in place, and there would be people like this guy, Webb Pierce, who took his place, and Johnny Horton literally took his widow as well. And but people kept doing that high nasal sound, like the Webb Pierce really had a piercing nasal voice. And you see that he has this nudie suit on, which is because nudie is the name of the tailor. And this became, Hank didn't wear these things. Hank had that simple cowboy hat and suit, but the country starts to get a little more ostentatious after his death. And that becomes the look of country, like through the 70s in a lot of ways.
Yeah, I know, obviously you're an expert on sounds and that fashion, but yeah. Can you talk a little bit about that? I mean, that is funny how, iconic the aesthetic of country music. And do you know much about like how it started or?
Yeah, I know. I've definitely read and listened to histories of it. And, a lot of it is just coding for audiences too. Like you're trying to appeal to like Tammy Wynette appeals to a certain look with audience with her look. And but with in terms of the nudie suit, it was sort of like Western wear, because prior to honky tonk, there was a lot of singing cowboys. And so there would be flair on their costumes, and there would be a lot of crossovers with Hollywood stars. I forget who specifically, it may have been Webb Pierce, maybe it may have been somebody else, started getting these these nudie suits, and it became a competition. Like they would have more and more ostentatious and heavy, like with rhinestones and really over the top images. And that would also be frankly pretty difficult to wear on stage. Like they would be heavy and hot. And somebody like a Porter Wagoner would have a whole mess of outfits, but then there would be some people that could only afford one and would keep wearing the same one. There's a podcast called Cocaine and Rhinestones that Tyler Mahan Coe, who is the son of David Allen Coe, it's a history of country music in the 20th century. And if anybody was interested in looking more about nudie suits, he has a whole episode devoted to the fashion. But it's also true that, you have anti-fashion in the 70s, like once you have the rise of the redneck hippies with Willie Nelson. Like Willie Nelson is sort of fascinating to look at image, because if you, as I said earlier, he was with Ray Price's band. So he would sort of have that sort of straight laced honky tonk look. And then in the 60s, he was going pop and he had like lots of turtlenecks and sweaters. And so he's like very sophisticated And that didn't really take. And then once he heard Doug Somm and Waylon Jennings down in Austin, and he just started growing out his hair into braids and wearing jeans and sneakers, and that became the Willie Nelson that we all know and love. And it's because once he gets his image in the early 70s, he sort of sticks with that until today. But if the 60s, Willie looks a lot different. And so, but it's always true, like, you know, like pop stars or country stars, any kind of stars have to, what you're dressing as sort of attracts the audience you want. You know what I mean? So. And then we have Lefty Frizzell here, who is one of the biggest, the greatest honky tonk singers, particularly with ballads. And he was a very deep influence on Merle Haggard and Randy Travis, like a very lush baritone voice that, Willie Nelson also covered his Always Late With Your Kisses in the 70s. So that's another interesting thing to me about, like, the hits of the 50s, 40s to 50s become a repertoire that bands just played at honky tonk. So then if you look at the stars of the 70s, the Willies and the Waylons and Merles, they can draw upon all these songs that they always played. And Willie Nelson continued to even record songs like this into the 2000s, 2010s. So, you know, he would play them on stage, but he would also do new versions of songs that he's been recording since the 50s. And I used to think that was not particularly interesting, but as I get older, I like to hear the different points, how people take songs at different points of their career, like different tempos, or Willie's especially one that his phrasing changes. And so it's interesting to see how it develops.
Actually, I'll pause you there too to talk about the soundtrack that you put together for the exhibition. So Crooked Yard Center Petoskey was able to add a new sound system to our galleries, and Dear Tom here put together, how long is the playlist? 7.5 hours?
Something like that. And so it could be sequenced a little bit better, but it was trying to put in as many different kinds of songs that could possibly be called honky tonk.
Well, it's pretty fun, and it's piping in our galleries, but we also have access for people to grab that list. And if I can, I'll feed that into the chat. Sure. Because when I was previewing it for the show, just that notion that you're talking about, Tom, the different versions of the tracks, some songs I knew, I didn't know the track that you put in the list. And I was like, oh, this is a good one, you know? And yeah. it's interesting to think about that, those different renditions, and how that kind of keeps that sound going but evolving.
Did you have anything like that particularly struck you, like in terms of eras or different kinds of singers that caught your ear?
I did, whether I can remember it, I feel
that's
like
totally
it was
fine.
So I didn't know Webb Pierce, right? So oh, really? I think that was actually something that was new for me. And when I pull up that list to share in the chat, I'll see if I can remember, but it was certain tracks that I'd be like, oh yeah, you know, I gotta check that out.
Webb Pierce has a very distinctive voice. Like, it'll cut through the clamor at a gallery pretty easily.
But it's a fun mix because, you know, personally, I find myself pretty drawn to these, that probably, you know, some of the sounds from the 40s and then some of these sounds from the 70s, and I didn't really carry it further. And I think it's kind of cool to think about, you know, I don't want to jump ahead, you'll get there,
no,
but the other artists that have been influenced in the way that those sounds carry on, being able to incorporate that through the audio is kind of cool too.
Well, I just got kicked off because of Adobe Flash, so cute.
That's okay.
So sorry about that. Anyway, I'll just keep talking.
Bring it back.
Yeah, I'm trying to get it there. Embarrassed by this, my apologies, everybody.
No worries. While we're transitioning, anybody in attendance have any questions for Tom, either about that history or his background or what you notice in the show? You can go ahead and feed those into the chat or the Q&A. So Tom, do you have favorites?
Oh yeah, I mean, I definitely do have favorites. I would say that I like a lot of things that are based on Ray Price, but that also includes people like Roger Miller and you know, Johnny Paycheck and Willie Nelson, of course. And Merle Haggard remains one of my absolute favorites. And let's see.
And we do have a good question popping into the chat here, which is, Tom, I'm curious how large your record collection is now. Oh. So that's something that I wanted Tom to write and talk about too, is this whole notion of collecting, because it's so much. But how would you answer that?
Yeah, my record collection fluctuates over the years because I've also moved across the country a few times. So that changes a lot of things. And I have been working at home since long before the pandemic. So I've digitized most of the stuff that I come in, and like since probably mid 2000s, I ripped stuff. So I have a very large hard drive of things that I've reviewed and listened to. Together, my wife and I probably have several hundred LPs, but I think that I'm topped out at around 1500 CDs at the moment. It used to be upwards of 4000 or so, but I've really had to pare it down because, you know, moves, and then also, like, you know, having my stepdaughters, like I can't ask them to have CDs in their room, even though it's had happened sometimes, but it's
they need some space too, right?
Yeah, they do need some space, and I want to be nice to them. But it fluctuates too, because like you know, it's different times. Like you then right now you can listen to a lot of things, sample it on streaming, where I used to buy you know, entire catalogs of somebody. Like you could get them for cheap somewhere, and like I would really dig into a particular artist, whether it was a country artist like Johnny Paycheck, or just like, oh, I want to hear all the Supertramp records or something like that. And that really coincided with how the All Music came about. And so like I would be in tandem, like doing the research and discovering as we're building the database. But yeah, and I would say that I have several gigs of digital music, and so
We have another great question, which we really don't talk about in the show, so thank you, Conrad, for this question. Were the songs in the genre from the 40s and 50s generally written by the performers? If not, any comments on the songwriters who wrote in this style?
That is a great song. So a great question. And it would be a combination. Like Hank Williams himself wrote most of his hits, not all of them. But he's definitely known as a songwriter. But at the time, there are definitely teams of professional Nashville songwriters. There always have been, like, and there would be publishing houses that might be geared to certain performers, and so they could write for somebody's specific voice, or there would be a song that gets shopped around. And this happened a lot, where everybody knows it's a hit, but they're trying to get it to the right artists. So there would be competing versions that happens. And that was big through rock and roll too. Like that's why I like that 50s and 60s era so much, is that, you know, it was a record industry where you could game the system, that you could do exploitative, like cheap knockoffs that might even be better than the original sometimes. But as far as the main songwriters go, like George Jones didn't write much. Like he had a handful of songs, but he wasn't much of a writer. Merle Haggard is a hell of a writer, as is Roger Miller. And those would be the main singer-songwriters. But the notion of like of the idea that the artist has to write their own songs, that wasn't as big a deal in the 40s and 50s. People liked the songs, and the 60s is where it transitions, thanks to people like Bob Dylan and the Beatles, where it becomes a self-contained unit. Now there were others, like Chuck Berry was self-contained, like he wrote pretty much everything. Buddy Holly and Bo Diddley wrote a lot of their their songs too. But that notion that the performer has to be the one that writes their own material really took hold after the Dylan revolution. And country music, like today, like that's not necessarily true all the time. Like if you're in mainstream, you might get credits on your songwriting credits on your record, but you'll have a number of songwriters that help you out. Like there's definitely like go-to writers that people in a room like workshop the songs. But if you're more on the Americana side of things, where it's just the more authentic brand of country, that's you're seeing like you have to write your own songs there. It's a weird dichotomy that happens. So all right. Do we have another question or?
We do. That's why I paused. I was trying to decide if we wanted to. I think we can. Why don't you go ahead a couple slides and tell us about those people, and then I'm gonna. We've got some questions about contemporary stuff, so we will get to that.
Yeah. So we have time. Buck Owens here, who is along with Merle Haggard.
Hey Tom, yep. Can you go ahead and do the view present so we can just see?
I knew that I was doing something wrong.
We're good. Our slideshow.
That's it. This is your. This is why you're the professional here. Buck Owens, so this is in the 60s. He was also later on Hee Haw, got fame there, but he was really the person that put Bakersfield, California country on the map. And this is where, as you can see, an electric guitar and drums really becomes part of the kinds of honky tonk. Like it's transition from Ray Price to this electrified sound. Buck Owens and Merle Haggard are the two real key figures of West Coast country in the 60s. And here we have Dolly Parton with Porter Wagoner. And you can see this isn't one of the gaudiest of Porter's suits, but he was really kind of the king of Nashville gothic pop. And he had a TV show where Dolly Parton stepped into a departing singer, and Dolly became a huge star through that, and she pivoted, of course, into her own celebrity. And Dolly's another one who is an amazing songwriter, and she does, you know, she covers other people's songs quite regularly, but she still writes amazing songs to this day.
Go back to Dolly for a second. We did have the opportunity to bring a couple groups of fifth graders to the galleries before school ended, and I was really curious how they would respond to all of these stars from the past and images from the 1970s. And of course, the one that everyone could recognize was Dolly, because we do have a great photo of her. But then also, and I'm sure we'll get to this individual, but Waylon Jennings, those are the two that far carrying through the generations. I thought you might find it interesting.
That's fascinating to me, just because, you know, Dolly's so alive and really, really active. But Waylon's been gone for a while, and he has a sort of an outsized influence on what people think of as outlaw country even to this day. And there's a lot of people that sound like him.
With Dolly, I don't think it was until we were working on this project and these images, because we have images of both of these folks from the 1970s, that I realized that that's how she began. How did she break out into her solo career?
Well, her fame started to eclipse, and she's always had a big ambitions, you know, and so she did approach Porter and said that she was going solo, and it was actually on amicable terms. And the weird thing is, she became such a superstar that, you know, as you said, you don't really know about the Dolly and Porter years, but they dominated the country charts for a while, and the music is fantastic. Like it was some of the best stuff that she's done too, so. But she just, at a certain point, it was clear that she was overshadowing Porter. And I think that maybe he even would have been okay with it, just because, you know, yeah, sizable ego himself. So, and then—
All right, we've got a question that kind of feeds into this era still. Could you comment a little bit more on the influence of African-American music on early honky-tonk artists like Bob Wills?
Yeah, well, there's definitely, a lot of crossover and people going drawing from the same sources. And Bob Wills drew heavily from blues and jazz, and like the idea of a big swing band, which was tended to be more African American, like it got transferred over to the Western swing band, which would have still have horn sections, and but it would prominently have the fiddle and country and other country instrumentation. But you know, it's not, you know, there was a lot of cross-pollination, and there was all the way through even the era that's predominantly known as, you know, white country. Like there were some great African-American singers from the 70s here too, 60s, 70s, like Stoney Edwards, that just didn't get a lot of coverage because there was Charlie Pride, who was like the one African-American star that Nashville sort of rallied behind, because he was fantastic, and he also was able to play he knew how to play the industry. Like he wound up, there's no question that, you know, Hank Williams and Bob Wills and a lot of the earlier honky tonk Western swing people absolutely drew from African Americans, and it's just gets obscured, I think.
Okay, so who are we looking at here?
This is George Jones. Is probably the greatest country singer of all time, or is like widely acknowledged among fans and critics. And he's somebody that really patterned himself after Hank Williams and his earliest stuff. But then he took a little bit from Lefty Frizzell, and he had a really rich, resonant baritone ballad style. And that while he would still have a taste for novelties like The Race Is On, but he also recorded He Stopped Loving Her Today, which was people often say is the best country song ever made, which it's very good. I'm not sure if I would agree, but that was from the 1980, and his biggest fame was in the 60s, and then in the 70s he was with Tammy Wynette, who had the mammoth hit The Stand By Your Man, and they had really a tumultuous relationship that was documented in tabloids, and it's still makes for really absorbing reading. So, and then we have Waylon here, and I really am fascinated that that's a figure that everybody knows, because Waylon is probably the one that pushed honky tonk into the outlaw thing. Like I referred to with Willie earlier, is like the Nashville system didn't work for him. He had some hits, but he wrote some great songs, but he was just pushing up against how his label wanted to make records, because there was a very strict formula, particularly on RCA, the label that he was with Chet Atkins as the producer, that he wanted to use his own band and more of a earthier sound, and that's what he finally got to do with Honky Tonk Heroes, and the impact was enormous. It just kept reverberating until today. Really good body work too. And there's Willie, who we all know, I believe. And that's a Trigger, his guitar, who our cousin Mark actually takes care of, like down in Austin. And I think if there's profiles on Mark and Trigger that we could get to people. And then this is the Broken Spoke in Austin. I've seen several shows here because I currently live in Austin. But this is one of the last remaining dance halls and honky tonks in Tootsies these days. And we have Doc Watson here, and Doc Watson is part of the exhibit. And I think this points that Doc is more of a folk singer, but they're into the 70s and the 80s, which is an era that Henry documents, is like there's a lot of crossover between honky tonk and folk, and that becomes like a roots music scene, like it does. And I think that lays the groundwork for what we know as Americana today, that there's a lot of people that just like hearing the pure versions of folk and country. And then as far as traditionalists go, this is George Strait, and he's brought it back to the sound of, you know, Bob Wills and Ray Price, and modernized it some for the 80s, and he became the biggest, most consistent country star of the last 40 years. And one thing that fascinates me about George Strait versus, say, Garth Brooks is that he's had this enormous success. Like, he'll draw more than any other people, like, even like to this day, but he doesn't have any pop crossovers at all. Like, whereas, you know, Dolly had pop hits, and even Garth has some sort of pop's presence. He is firmly country. Like, I would imagine that most people that just listen to the pop starts, you might know his name, but you don't know his music. That's interesting. Like, I think this is the point where you could have that kind of mammoth success, but that's also ties into how the touring industry changed too, and the record industry changed, where you can really have, like, in the early 70s, which is what a lot of Henry's document, the circuits were just starting to develop, and the PA systems were just starting to develop, which means that you're more likely to have clubs and local scenes. But once you're able to do big arena shows that have a quality sound, that really doesn't take hold as early as you think. It's a development over the course of the 70s, and it really takes hold in the 80s. So, and do you have other questions?
We do have questions, but I sort of feel like let's see who you want to do shout outs to, and then we'll.
All right, and we have Randy Travis here and Randy Travis is another one of the Lefty Frizzell tradition that kept it alive in the 80s. Dwight Yoakam here was a revived Bakersfield sound, and with a little bit of a punk edge in the 80s. And these were happening almost simultaneously.
What's Bakersfield sound?
That's the Buck Owens, Merle Haggard sound. That's a lot of twangy guitars and very forceful drum beats. And so, and Buck Owens was so big in the 60s, it was that the Beatles covered him on Help. They did his Act Naturally. Now we're into the modern years era here, and we have Margo Price, who is who's one of the better traditionalist country singers right now. And she's very much like Loretta Lynn or an heir to Dolly Parton. And this is Joshua Headley, whose new album, Neon Blue, is probably the best just straightforward honky-tonk barroom country that I have heard in years. I thoroughly recommend it. And then this is what Broadway looks like now. So it's like you have the Broadway in Nashville. So there's a lot of different neon lights, and it's modern. It's not the era that Henry has documented at all, so.
Sorry, I'm muted. We have some questions. I'm going to go ahead and share now. Those of you in attendance, go ahead and add them into the chat. Seems to be working great, but we do have the Q&A going as well. And I think we can kind of see some of what this question is about as we went through those slides. So I'm just going to read it verbatim.
Sure.
Contemporary acts allude to honky-tonk, whether it's in fashion, aesthetic, cross-genre collaboration, and small club shows. I'm thinking of Casey Musgraves for fashion, mm-hmm. Old Town Road with Lil Nas X and Billy Ray, that collaboration, Midland and Tyler Childers right off the bat. Would you please talk about this kind of nostalgia in music today?
I think Midland's a great comparison, because Midland really almost goes for that George Strait era, like that you becomes like refractions and mirrors, like you're looking back to a tradition of a tradition sort of thing. And I think that with Lil Nas X, it's interesting to me because he plays with iconography. Like, I don't think that he's particularly well-versed in country, but that doesn't mean that he's not making country music, and it doesn't have like its own resonance, because like playing with a Billy Ray Cyrus, who was not loved in the 90s, but you know, Achy Breaky Heart still like withstood time. And it's like, I think that this era produced different visuals, whether it's the nudie suits or cowboy hats or the leather of Waylon, and that you can play with, and that if you're wearing it, it suggests that you're part of the tradition, even if your music's not necessarily part of the tradition. And Kacey Musgraves is interesting because she sort of started within that like updating of outlaw, and then she has really moved into modern music, like synthesized really gorgeous textures. And yeah, but Midland are interesting because they do zero into like an, almost the urban cowboy sound, the softer honky tonk sound of the early 80s. And then Tyler Childers, I think I put him on a continuum with Sturgill Simpson, that have, he has a strong bluegrass part of his music. He did a, I believe it's, he did a bluegrass album recently that was really, really good. And that moves more towards the Americana thing. Like Midland makes commercial music. Tyler Childers makes music that can, that is definitely finding an audience, but it's not really made for radio play, in my opinion.
Yeah, and I think that notion that you at least brought it up somewhere along the conversation about the, I mean, now I'm going to get into art talk, right? The concept of authenticity with this stuff, right? But there's still like so much of a core identity that's tied to whatever music genre you're in, but certainly within country music. So are those debates that happen kind of internally, like, ooh, this is the real country music.
It doesn't stop actually because everybody, there's always a segment of the country music that gets, audience that gets nostalgic for the way things were, and they usually get nostalgic for things that were called sellouts at the time, like, or some, things that weren't authentic. And so that has been the history of since the post-war, basically, is that everybody said there's a sellout, but then with hindsight, that sellout starts to seem authentic. And people that get, there are a lot of people that get all too uptight about the notion of authentic country music, and it's part of real heated debates even now. So we may cover this more, and we're going to have another Zoom session next month or in August, or I believe with a couple of other writers that we might be able to cover some of these topics in depth, because I know that they have a lot to say too.
And kind of along that vein, another question in the chat is, could you name some artist bands from Randy Travis to the present who keep some of this honky tonk music going? So you did do a couple shout outs to some folks already.
Yeah, and I know I'm gonna blank, but Randy Travis is terrific. And I really do like this Josh Headley and Margo Price. There's also people like Dale Watson or the Derailers that keep a certain kind of barroom country. They work their own circus, like Texas through Tennessee, and there are definitely more. I'm blanking a little bit, unfortunately. But go check out that Joshua Headley album.
What's the album called?
Neon Blue.
Oh, right.
It came out 3-4 months ago or something like that. 90s, like, there, I'm like, Dwight Yoakam moves away from Bakersfield a little bit. It's hard because the 90s have such an overblown production style all the way through. Like, even if you listen to some like rootsier stuff from the 90s, it still sounds sort of big. But BR 459 was a good band from that time that was, and Junior Watson, I think I might, it was a good.
All right, so I don't know how I would think about this one. So this question is, do you think it's possible for another traditional revival on the country music charts, like in the mid 80s, when Steve Earle, Dwight Yoakam, O'Kane, Foster and Lloyd had significant hits?
I think that's, I think you might have, the charts work so differently now. The charts are so driven on streaming, and like, it's hard to, and those get sort of gamed by algorithms, that you can't have like a fluke hit that runs through different markets and different radio. So I think what would happen is there would be an unexpected sensation, like this year, not in the not in country, but like with the Kate Bushes running up that hill, being in Stranger Things, all of a sudden becomes a top 10 hit, you know, 35 years after it's released or whatever. I could see something like that happen. And I also know that there are trends, like different scenes, that there are people that are trying to play what they believe, like, not just authentic music, but sort of brings it into contemporary times, which is why I like the Margo Price and Josh Headley or Tyler Childers, that I do think that they're playing with tradition, but don't seem fussy about it. And so they might not be on the charts, but they could sustain an audience for a while. And I think that's generally with most genres right now. It's either hits are hard to come by, so there's a real deficit of attention. It's like the biggest artists in every genre get too much attention, and so it's harder for people to break through.
Yeah, that's interesting. We had a couple weeks ago, we had a local custom amp maker do one of our talks. That's Avery Amps. You guys should check it out. But he had a couple of musicians talking and thinking about, you know, really how we've seen that shift. And you've already talked about it, about how we receive and find music so different, right, than in the 80s and 90s and certainly the 70s, for how those hits are released, albums, if they're even a thing anymore, right? How do you see that impacting sound? Because like all genres of culture, we're in our own little bubble, right?
I'm using fascinating too much, but it is fascinating. Thing about modern music, like if you cherry picked songs from pop, R&B and country, there's a certain kind of sort of amorphous, soft sound that ties, like it's sort of like the derisive word for it is Spotify core, that it's just music that's sort of pleasant background music, and the same production aesthetics are tie that go across genre, because the idea is that it can get into a number of different playlists, mood-based playlists, sure, almost more so than the genre-based one. So I think you see things that music is definitely affected by streaming to that sense, that there's a lot of playing for this sort of mushy middle. And it's unfortunate, because like I always like listening for distinctive voices, whether it is somebody that's completely commercial or somebody that's underground. And I think that we lose that when people are just trying to go for like all-purpose algorithms.
Yeah, that's fascinating. Okay, everybody, we are just a couple minutes from end of time. So are there any final questions for those in attendance? All right, and we have one. Thank you, Conrad. A bit off topic, do you have a different feeling when you listen to one of your LPs compared to when you were listening to one of your digitized songs?
I would say that it's focus of intention most of the time. Like digitized, I think that sure, there can be difference in terms of analog or versus digital quality, but if you get the right equipment, digital still sounds really good. But for me, it's a focus of attention. Like, you know, we can put on, not that we have recently due to babies, but you can put on a record and it's like, that's where you're at. You put it, you're focusing your attention and you're in that space for a while. Whereas digital, particularly streaming, but also it's true whether it was on your phone or an iPod, that you can skip around too much, and but it requires more of you to lock in. So I think that's the chief attribute of analog media, is that you get to cut things out and like you don't have distractions, and I think that there's some considerable worth to that.
Sorry, I had to find my mic. Well, everybody's saying thanks in the chat. And thanks, Tom. Are there any final closing comments that you want to share with us?
Well, we do have something else scheduled at the end of August, right, Liz?
Yes, I was just pulling that up to share. Do you want to tell us about the focus for that panel while I confirm our date?
Yeah, I think that it's more about like contemporary country and the legacy, if any, of Honky Tonk, and we'll probably get into, and you all had wonderful questions, and you could pepper us more with that sort of things about questions of authenticity and what's happened, or like who kept the sound revival and So it's with a couple of colleagues of mine, David Cantwell, who just published a book on Merle Haggard, and Marissa Moss, who's just published a book called Her Country, which is focused on Casey Musgraves, Margot Price, Miranda Lambert, Chicks, and like basically trying to help center women voices in country music. So I check out both of the books and join us again, because this was a lot of fun and I'm looking forward to the next one.
Yeah, and I'm gonna go ahead and put that date here into the chat. These do get saved. So that's August 25th at 10 a.m. That's also on Zoom and Facebook. And we have for our Michigan folks, I will also let you know that we have photographer Doug Coombe, and I know Doug and Tom know each other.
Great.
So he'll be coming up on August 11th. That'll be an in-person presentation, and he'll talk about his music photography in the Detroit and Ann Arbor area. So that'll be a lot of fun. And then we have a couple other talks that are in conjunction with Goodheart Artists in Residence Program. So check our website, sign up for our emails. You won't miss one, and it'll be a lot of fun. So thanks so much, Tom. I look forward to talking music with you again soon.
Yeah, take care. Thanks, everybody. All right.